Any other than that nation. That's who I am through my family. In the Western world, I'm a professor at the University of California, Davis, at the Native American Studies Department. I'm honored to be here to support my sister. as we're getting ready today at UC Davis, bringing in the new graduate students, the undergrads, the Native American Studies Department is teaching them the history. We are introducing them to voices, Jack Ford, Mission Dolores, people who have spoken out about these atrocities. Where they have not heard these stories in grade school, they're getting it through our teachings up there. We are not alone today, because we have other indigenous people on our side. And it's because we have connections across the Pacific. We think of the people at Mauna Kea. They think of us here. It's strong. But one of the things I want to, there was a quote, I looked up a Mission Dolores. And his quote is, "Those who are afraid of hell seek religion. Those who have been through hell seek spirituality." And Vine, as that people know, he was a theologian first and then went into the academic world. So we have people who have said things, who have backgrounds. Take for instance Jack Ford. He said, "There have been incredible teachers walking the world. We have Buddha, Muhammad, Allah, we have all of these other teachers, Tecumseh, even Jesus Christ. But the way they are interpreted." Another thing that Jack Ford says is, "What we do is our religion. What we do during the day and when no one is watching is our religion. If we pray, that is our religion. If we gossip, that is our religion. If we dig up bones, that's our religion. Whatever you do is your religion." I'm speaking these words not just on my behalf. My wife and I have a little boy. His name is Amari Montgomery Pasalacqua. He's Pitt River. He came to us when he was 1 year old. When he hit fourth grade, and they tried to make him make a mission and accept that doctrine, I don't think so. He's already in his faith. He's starting to understand, and that's a lot to teach a little person. That's a heavy load to give to a little person. So here, us here, we're helping them. We will be carrying that load for them as long as we can. And in honor of my son, Harry. Oh.
The ancestors, for the blessings of this day, for the blessings of the knowledge that I have received through the gift of my daughter who's here, Catherine, and the gift of perseverance in the face of the colonizer's attempt to erase us from existence. The colonizer's attempt to kill us and destroy us. An attempt that my father carried with him to his grave, not telling us of our heritage to keep us safe from the genocide that the state of California authorized through the militia and the law. A law that didn't end until the 1920s. So I thank the Creator, the grandmothers, the grandfathers for the gift of knowledge and learning of our heritage, the beginnings of new knowledge of our culture, of our history. And from that knowledge comes strength to resist, the strength to say to the colonizers and their descendants, no more. This is our land. This is our land. We're happy to share it with you, perhaps, but this is our land. And it is time for us to assert our right to control that land as much as the so-called colonizer owners using colonizer law claim ownership. It all starts with the land. And it all starts with knowledge. The knowledge of our history. The painful knowledge that mostly stops me from speaking and causes me to cry when I read of the atrocities committed in the name of civilization, and yet they call us savages. I proudly claim my heritage as a savage Indian. No more. No more. Let the security forces that they assemble to try to stop us watch in wonderment because they cannot stop us. No more. Over. Thank you, Creator. Thank you, Grandmother. Thank you, Grandfather. Thank you, Karina. Wounded Knee. Luta. All of my relatives, thank you. Aho.
Hello, everybody. My name is Dolores Steele. My family comes from San Luis Potosí, so we are actually the first tribe ever to be contacted by Junipero Serra. But I think it's funny because often they try to invisibilize them when there's more than 12,000. And lots of times we try to think that this is a struggle that's separate, right? Because a border separates us, but also colonize our language. So Spanish and English make us believe that we're different, that we're so different, but that often we share the same history. My family, for us, my mother comes from El Saucillo, and that's where my family's from. But the truth is, I would say that most of Latin America is affected by mission systems. Mm-hmm. Often you don't see that many people here because of the shame that comes with being native. And a lot of things that are happening right now currently and what people call Latin America have already taken place here in California and other parts of the U.S. as well as Canada. So, I want to make sure that people remember that the only person that has a right to say that this man is a saint are native people, because he has made a saint because of his relation to us. So we, as a native collective, I would say, we're the only ones that have a right to say whether this man becomes a saint or not. And it's like when the church condones this behavior, it makes a mockery of sainthood altogether. So I just want to just keep that in mind that, you know, yeah, we could be really pissed off, we could be angry, and we could be very emotional. But ultimately, for people who are practicing the Catholic faith, or people that are not practicing the Catholic faith, right? I think you would have to be Catholic to believe in statehood. But for those that are Catholic, you know, to whatever floats your boat. But the truth is, at the end, even you as a Catholic native have a right to say whether this man is a Catholic. So, yeah. Have a good day, everybody.
Oh. Hello.
Creator of all that is, God, who we know and love by many names, thank you for our life. Thank you for this day. Thank you for the breath of life that is with us, each of us. God, we feel you here, moving us to speak and to witness today. Call on all of our ancestors, thank you for being with us, for that great cloud of witness that we know has been with us from the beginning. My prayers today are for our strength, yes, but also I pray for the spirit of peace, which passes understanding, to be with the Pope and to be with the Catholics today. And I pray that spirit of peace moves the fear and anger out of their hearts. I pray that spirit of peace move the fear out of their hearts such that they are no longer afraid of not having enough, that they need to take it from other people.
Today.
learned so far on this journey with the Native peoples of Shaman Paul. We are representatives of the church, of an institution that has enabled and paved the road for empire, militarization, colonization, and so much brutality on this continent and other continents, but particularly here, particularly right here in California. I just came back from the Central America, and we prayed with the people there, indigenous peoples who are being displaced by the same ideology of faith, the same ideology of imperialism, the same justification that were used 300 years ago by Father Junipero Serra are being used today in our name. So I wanted to share with you, because as Elder Wounded said, people dressed like us say a lot of too many words. I want to share with you some gestures, prayers that we would like to offer and share with you with our bodies to express not our words, but our feeling, our hearts, and our bodies, the posture that we should have.
I think it's a good one. Some of you may want to join me, but this is a gesture of penance. This is a gesture of penance. And this is what should be happening today. Not the glorification, the sanctification. But a gesture asking for forgiveness. Just a gesture saying, 300 years later, we know better.
What gesture of truth can you give us? you're all related.
About the mission system. You tell the truth about California indigenous. You tell the truth that we are all brothers and sisters. No one greater and no one less.
My name is Reverend Israel Alvaran. I'm a United Methodist clergy from the Philippines. We are a colonized people. It's somewhat very thankful to Sego, and I am ashamed and repentant of an institution that I am part of that has led to the colonization of not just my people, but so many. And I invoke my own ancestors who have been killed. Over 300 years of colonial rule, both under Spain and the United States, that have brought religion, the Christian religion, to our shores, but in a way has robbed my own people of its dignity, of its land, of its resources, and still continues today in the empire that is both religion and the United States. I also come not just as a person of color and a clergy person, I come as a Buddhist. United Methodist clergy. The church and religion has colonized our own bodies and identities as queer people. The same that it has colonized people of color, the working class, and the poor. Our struggles are one. Our struggles are one. That's why I also invoke my queer ancestors from the Philippines and elsewhere who have died, who have suffered under the discrimination, because of the discrimination perpetrated by the morals of the church and of religion in general, that have said that queer people are lesser. And that is not the truth. Because we are all human beings and we share the same dignity. So may our ancestors' bloods mingle today in tears, in faith, for their blood and ours will lead this fight forward. We shall struggle together as people of color, as indigenous people, as queer people, working class, oppressed people, for our struggle is righteous. And for that, I join you in solidarity today. And I am deeply wounded by what is happening today in D.C., for it is so ironic that a leader of the church from a colonized country will canonize somebody who is a conquistador. It pains me. I would like to say I hate it. I really do. And I am angry. And I will channel that by building communities of struggle, of liberation with you. Thank you for your work today and for allowing us to be here.
Thank you. I don't want to be up here. I don't want to stop. But I kind of have to. My name is Rico Miranda. I'm from Cinnabon. It's hard to celebrate the equinox and celebrate our fall ceremony when that daily morning is in your face. For me and many other Native people around the world, it's a daily experience of living in a colonized, in our own colonized. Enough to meet several people throughout the South Pacific that came here, sailed here, and and sat there and they looked at the city and they said, wow, how do you do it? How do you look around every day and see all of this in your tribal land? It's not easy. Shuduru, all of you folks for being out here. The warriors that are always going to all the protesting events. I don't. Can't handle it. What I do is honor my ancestors by learning my culture, learning my language, making that culture alive by dancing my ceremonies, by singing my songs, by teaching my children and other children. Like I said, I don't want to be here today. We said, get up there, you need to be able to stand up there. I don't want to be up there. But I thank you all for your support.
The Ocampo family, they walk, okay, they're just a beautiful family. I knew my sister, Lee, and I'm also, I'd like to just acknowledge the ancestors. You know, there's a lot of ancestors that are, you know, they're, I'm an ancestor, you're an ancestor, but Wounded Knee Ocampo and his sister, B Ocampo, and the Valley brothers, and now their daughter, the daughter carrying on, Morningstar Valley. And so many, you know, it would be nice if people could live their lives, raise a family, get an education, express yourself in whatever your trade or art could be, live in peace. But it's one issue after another. And those of us who have been in the struggle all our life, you know, we never have a chance to rest. But some of us maybe practice the struggle by taking care of our elders, being really patient with our elders and with our children, spending time with our families instead of, you know, going out and socializing or even turning on the TV, but just looking at our family members. And when we have elders, we really need to listen to them, you know, sit at the table with them and look at them when they eat and talk to them and ask them questions, because they're the treasure. They're our ancestors right here on earth.
And I keep thinking of the Gali brothers because, you know, there's three brothers already in my lifetime who I was friends with, who I knew that are gone to the spirit world, and that's just one out of one family. So because there's one issue after another, then people are not able to just live their life. They have to run to this issue and then run fight that issue, and it's going on against indigenous people in the land all over the world. I would just like to acknowledge the Ocampo family and thank you for being there, brother, year after year after year. And I would see you by from afar. You know, I'm sitting here, my elderly mom, I can't be there at all times, but I see you. You're out there. Selena's out there. There's so many people just, they're present, you know, camping for months, holding down the land until victory with their prayers. And the beautiful thing is, over the years, as we've been watching the struggle, our people have learned something. We've learned from our ancestors who are present, we'll say, by listening to our grandmothers and grandfathers and fathers and mothers, because we're just, our generation, the generation that came of age in the 60s, we're about the, you know, the last generation that knows elders who really know the knowledge, that know how to listen when the wind speaks. They know the signals. They know the language when Mother Earth speaks. In our generation, we're just, you know, barely catching up learning, but we've learned enough to just not make it all political, but to make it prayerful. And that's why we're starting to win, because people have learned that our way is prayer way.
Uh-huh.
You know, politics is somebody else's way. And the thing about politics is that they are the ones who run that, and so they can change the rules on it. You know, you play it a long time to do politics, but then people who are in politics is another kind of people. And the people who have been struggling year after year after year have started listening to the elders, maybe get into ceremonies, start really taking the traditions seriously and practicing and living them, continuing the traditions. And so then what's happened is people have gone more towards the prayer way. And so now when we have a gathering, it's not a demonstration, it's a prayer. It's a ceremony. And that's what we're here for. We're here to pray, to acknowledge all the slaves, the enslaved ancestors that were buried here, that are under the parking lot, that are under the street. My brother over here, what's your name, brother? You're the one who told me that that there's bodies, the ancestors all the way down the Mission Street, up King Street, not just on the parking lot. I'd also like to acknowledge Carolyn Holland and her son Kagan Holland, who are walking 650 miles at this particular time from one mission to another, and who they came through here last week. See, it's so beautiful. Everybody's doing what they know what to do. Coming from their heart, just like we're all trying, doing whatever we can do. And that's very beautiful. I'd like to acknowledge the strength and the wisdom that's coming from inside people. They're tapping into, like, nobody needs to lead them. They're just being led by the spirit within them and by their ancestral ways. Just my knowledge or my experience with California Indian people, not only are they very beautiful people, very sweet people and kind people, they're just prayerful people, just really beautiful people. And I'm grateful to, even though I'm of Nicoya descent, my parents are from Central America, Nicaragua, but I'm just grateful that they're here in California, because the California people, the original people of California, are such a beautiful, beautiful people. Anyway, so speaking of beautiful, beautiful people, there's a great Indian doctor and healer, Grandpa Raymond Stone, he lived in Big Pine, California. He's probably from Big Pine. And I'd like to offer his eagle song to all the ancestors that are buried here. And one thing that Carolyn pointed out when she was here last week, the lady who's walking with her son the length of the mission, is that under every mission, usually under the school parking lot, is buried the ancestors that were enslaved here. And once people got captured, they were not allowed to leave. And if people would read that book that just came out by Elias, I think it was it Throne of Thorns? What, Cross of Thorns. I highly recommend it. There it is. I haven't read it yet, I have to admit, but I just ordered it. Anyway, that tells the truth about the horrible tortures that the people of this land were subjected to if they rebelled, and they were set as an example. And what happened with Junipero Serra was he brought the Inquisition over here and imposed it on people who had lived just kind lives. We will have to share, before I sing the song, one more thing. My great auntie was an indigenous lady from Nicaragua. She was dark-skinned Indian. She came here to become a doctor so that she could go back and help her people. She was dark-skinned Indian from Nicaragua in those days, 1930s, and so she got as far as a master's in neurology. But she had long hair, and she raised me strictly, you know, braids, dresses, no cuss words. And she taught me that our ancestors, they used to consider a conversation an exchange of bouquets of the mind between friends, and that our ancestors, the indigenous peoples of this land, didn't have cuss words in our languages. Our people didn't curse. Our people carried themselves beautifully. They had beautiful attire. Everything in life, object was beautiful. It was made with love, and it took time, and it was made with care. And there was just sweetness among the people. And she said that conversations were just like exchange of wisdom, exchange of knowledge, exchange of counsel, kindness. That's why in Central America, Mexico and Central America, the temples have the pictures of the people there in profile, and they have flowers coming out of their mouth, because that's what they were exchanging, the flowers of their mind, wisdom. And so just wanted to share that concept with you that I received from my great auntie Amanda Cuadra, RN. So I would like to offer this song. I want to face the cemetery where the spirits, ancestors here are, but there's ancestors buried all around here, thousands of ancestors. This is Grandpa Raymond's song, Mountain Eagle song. So,
of what is now San Francisco, what used to be Yalamu, you see hungry people every day. People were never homeless, and every day you see homeless people living on the streets. Every day you see people closing their doors to folks. This is what the missions brought to us. They brought us a different way of thinking about our lives, that our lives were more important than anyone else's. And a lot of Native traditions, we're taught that we should be humble because nothing on this earth needs human beings. But we need everything in order to survive. As human beings, we forget that sometimes. And I think that, you know, us coming together allows us to remember that we're human.
Yeah.
Awesome! I love it! We're going to be loud. I want to bring a couple of sisters up here who I met in 2011. I was blessed while I was on my traditional land in Segorite to have these women and some other Pacific Islanders come up and do some honoring songs for our ancestors up there. And they honored us with tapa cloth. And they have continued to be respectful and have always worked alongside of indigenous people's work here in the Bay Area since I have known them. And so I would like to bring up these two sisters, Laura and Fui Fui Lupe Numatola.
Maloyo fa, maloyo dahiba, kurina go. Kaina maloa pito homo, homo, maloa pito. Malo is deep of gratitude and humility from our heart. Seeing everyone speak and the prayers and the songs is very beautiful. I stand here with these sisters. This is Fui, I'm Loa, this is Zephyr, and this is Kapiolani. And we're going to be quick, you know. So we come from the Pacific. We're Tongans, and we're Native Hawaiian, and Zephyr was here.
I stand here for all my ancestors who come from Guanajuato, Mexico, of Nauna, Zapotec, and Mexica lands, as well as my European ancestors who also face the colonization of the Catholic Church as indigenous Romani and witches of Ireland and France.
Thank you, Zephyr. There's a purpose, Zephyr, standing here with the Pacific Islander sisters today because of the chant that she has learned with us. It's a Hawaiian chant, and the chant is a Ku Mau Mau. Many of you may know this chant. This chant is a sovereignty call for Hawaii. And we also stand here with, the Pacific stands here, Karina. We bring our hearts lay on this ground of this mission. Our hearts are open, and our hearts are always ready to fight. So we stand here, Karina, we bring the Free Wind Power Port movement with us right now. Fighting against the colonization of Indonesia, where the U.S. is very complicit in, and the corporations, the transnational corporations. We also bring the hearts of the Kaneka Maoli from Hawaii with Mauna Kea and the mountains. So let us get to, sisters, let us do our chant. Okay, this is the Hawaiian chant, a Ku Mau Mau. It's an ancient chant. It's when you go and get the gourd trees from the uplands and you bring it down to make the canoe for the journey, which is what we're on, brothers and sisters. We're on this journey together. And you have, you know, the gourd trees are huge and the double hull canoes are huge. So you have to work together. So you will hear our chant and what it means is like stand up, work together in solidarity, stand up at intervals because sometimes we are tired. Sometimes the leaders who are leading will be tired and the new leaders will have to stand. And then there are times we must rest, and we rest in particular ways. So it's a lot of love. Ofalayasu. Thank you so much. And Lord, we just also want to acknowledge and want to thank our brothers, our Pacific Islander brothers who taught us the chant. Actually, we want to acknowledge and honor our Pacific Islander brothers behind bars in Solana Prison. It was through the work that we did with our brothers that they taught us the chant. So we definitely acknowledge the sisters and the brothers behind bars.
Eku Mau Mau! Eku! Eku Mau Mau! Eku Hulu Hulu! Ika la de Mau! Eku! Eku la de Mau! 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 Echo
before me, they have spoken from their hearts. So thank you, Grandfather. So thank you. Oh. The song is for us people, for all of us. It's a naval song. And from our area, the song means help me. Help me be strong. Help me to help my family. Help me to help my people. And today we're all brothers and sisters here. So what this song is for is a strength song for all of us.
Yo, here. I want to thank Maria for inviting me here and always stand and support me in everything you do. I thank you. Want to say thank you to the spirits of the land here. And I pray for not just your very emotional. I was standing right there and, like, I'm not a good speaker, I always say, and my words is through song and prayer, and that's the way that I walk in prayer. And when I was standing here, and everybody was talking to me, and my flapper was just shaking and moving and just warm. So I come here and I sing here for the ancestors. And just thank everybody here, Karina and Wounded, and Louie, thank you for all being supportive, and everybody's words here, they're really beautiful. And I come here and ask the spirits of the plant permission to sing this song in a good way, a blessing song, and I ask please.
I rocked this jailhouse attire because me and my Poe, mixed race mama, did jail time just trying to stay alive and this holler. I start with that verse because I speak through verse to tell the story of thousands and millions of women and children and fathers and babies who are houseless and who have been colonized through generations of genocide and who no longer even remember who they are. And I go back to my mama right now because as the mixed-race daughter, Roma, Irish, Taino, of a Roma, Irish mama who believed in the Catholic Church no matter what, even though she was raped by her own father and put in a convent and had her baby stolen away from her and all of these other abuses and never even tripped off it because the Catholic Church was the one. And that the colonization is so deep that those of us who have lost our souls and our indigeneity and our history and our history, our trauma is so deep that we don't even remember who we are. And so as to this day, when this colonizer genocidal maniac, as Sister Karina calls him so aptly, is being canonized, we are ensuring that thousands and millions more people will not know their history and will not know who they came from and what they used to be and what is inside of us and what makes us we. Because these systems like this uphold the cult of independence and the lie of separation and the ideas that we don't need to worry about our elders, as a beautiful sister said earlier, and we don't need to practice humility, and we don't need to understand our historical trauma. We only need to look ahead and make money and be in the lie of success and look beyond our houseless brothers and sisters and not care about the fact that thousands and millions of incarcerated men and women, mostly indigenous, are behind these razor wire plantation prisons. But none of us have to care because we believe in these systems that tell us it's okay. So on this day, we as revolutionaries can name and claim, A, that this is stolen land, and A, that this is indigenous land, and A, that we are standing on our ancestors' shoulders, right? And that we are bringing them on to bring us spirit and strength to go forward. And that with that walk, we can help our future generations not believe in these lies. Our fourth, fifth, and sixth graders, of course, in these systems called the man schools, the public schools, are taught more lies. And those of us who are teachers are kind of always trying to retouch and reteach. So I just want to give love to every single person here in the middle of this week on the Gregorian calendar, on this stolen land, on top of our ancestors, to say this is the beginning of that decolonization. And we can thank all of you that walk with that spirit and that prayer and hold these ancestors in our hearts, that we can walk liberation. And we can take back the idea that anybody should profit off of Mother Earth. And there would not be gentrification, and there would not be thousands of houseless people if we stop believing in the lie that we can profit off of Mother Earth. So in my mama's stolen tongue, I will say my last prayer as a Taino daughter many, many, many generations away, looking like my colonizer father, I must say, because she believed in the lie that ascending to whiteness would make her rightness. Samin kakona wadi ataabi ho omateo.
Hello, my relations. Take a very deep, deep breath. Big, deep breath, everybody. Breathe. That's what we're made of. That's where our life comes from. Shake your feet a little bit. You've been standing on the sidewalk for a minute. Get some blood going back into your legs. And breathe. Hey, yo, Frank, hold up your sign. Do we think that's a little too subtle? My name is Tio. I'm also known as Marcus de Maria Arana, if you say it in the American way. I'm Marcus de Maria Arana. I'm descended from the Buelna family, the Arana family, the Arana.
She, Wahela John, Tinisha, Ashihin Nishlinto, Ashibashishin, Idisane Dashacheado, Kiaani Dashanele. I just introduced myself in my language. I'm Navajo, I'm Diné. And Salt Clan, born for the Red Bottom people. I'm from northern Arizona in a region called Black Mesa. And I reside in Oakland for the past 3 years. And I'm really honored to stand beside my relatives here in support and solidarity with Karina Maloney people. And I want to thank them for allowing me to be on their homeland. Their ancestral homeland, and all the other indigenous peoples in the region that they call this area home, and that they know the songs, the prayers, the connection to the mountains, to the ocean here, to the water, to the bay. I think that's very powerful, and that energy and that spirit continues. Today, you see it in my sister's voice and my brother's voice, and that resiliency, that strength of the ancestors is still here. So I just want to thank you all for being here, because we're going to need each other to stand up and continue to say no sainthood for Serra, and to call out the vicious attacks and the vicious agenda that the United States government, that the policies that they have to create these missions to be able to take over our land, to disrupt our way of life and our sacred connection to all living things. They did not succeed in that. Like I said, there's still that spirit of strength here. And so I'm really sad also to, I've been reading a lot about what's been actively going on in the effort to call out Junipero Serra, that this guy is a murderer. This person tortured a lot of women, tortured a lot of men, tortured grandparents, grandmas, and created that historical trauma on our children, our grandchildren, and our future generations. And so today, that recognition is out there, that indigenous peoples are standing up, that they're saying no more. That's enough. It's enough. Have respect. Accept who we are as indigenous peoples. Accept our way of life that is good for everything, all living things, that doesn't just matter to us as an individual. And now we think about everything. We think about our children, our seven generations from now. That's our teaching. What's so threatening about that teaching? when we think about our family and our community and our collectivity. So I'm really saddened by today, and I mourn with all of the ancestors that we have lost because of this agenda. And I just want to encourage my friends and my relatives to stay strong, and that we are here with you in solidarity. So I just wanted to offer that. Yeah.
The indigenous people who suffered from my ancestors. I renunciate what they did. I renunciate Serra as a saint. And I renunciate the torture and the pride that I had in my ancestry. When I was raised, I tell people, I'm a sixth generation Californian, and I get a rise out of that. And then I began to realize, how many generations would you say, as indigenous, you have here in this land and in this country? And I realized the land that was stolen. And I realized the lies that were said about our lineage, that once again we were pure Castilians, of course, pure blood. But that's not true. That's not true. There are African Americans and Native blood. But we had to show that we were pure, and we had to show that we were right, and we had to show that it was all right for us to own land here and to live in San Francisco for six generations, and to have the privilege of being white people here in this state and in this world and in this society. So I pray on the land here of Our Lady of Sorrows, because this is a sorrowful lineage that I have in my body. It's a hard realization.
Speak to the contradiction that we're living in right now. And the way I want to speak to it is to empower us and to let us know that we are divine.
Make a difference.
So I want you to envision with me that the Pope is hearing every prayer that's been said in every word, and that people, Catholic people and Christian people and Hindus and Muslims and all people who are now saying we want a just society are joining together. And as Joanna Macy says, there's a great turning happening, and we're all a part of it. White supremacy needs to die. And the twin sister of it, inferiority, needs to go. We need to remember that the sun shines on us all, that our father and our mother are one, that the lies about race are just lies. So if you close your eyes just for a moment and take a deep breath and center yourself in your place and understand that you are a divine being, and to realize that this Savior called Jesus, he was killed and he died because he had the audacity to say that being human was divine. I am the Son of God and you are the children of God. We stand in our rightful place, we honor our ancestors, and we say that this thing that the Pope is doing is a contradiction to all of the good stuff that he has been saying and where he is leading us. It's a contradiction. And with the power of our prayers, this contradiction will be reversed. This decision will be reversed because we do not accept it. Ashe and Aho.
All the way from Washington, D.C., he has the power to not allow us to actually go inside of my own mission. And so for me, I think that little guy, he's been the voice of Catholic indigenous people in California for way too long. He has been the voice that says that that California Indians are all for the colonization, or for, well, yeah, for colonization, right? But for Serra being canonized. He not only is saying that, but he is using young people on the front of the Catholic voice and boosting up their egos as young people, unknowing that they are also saying by using their bodies and regalia that they are also supporting this. So we're talking about telling the truth today, right? And so I want to tell the truth about this, because this man not only has embraced his colonization, but he desecrates our sacred sites, and he gets paid for it. You know, so I want to tell the truth. You know, I want to tell the truth about that. And he's pulling young people from the next generation into this with him as well. You know, there's a young man who's the junior docent at this place now, who's also a distant relative of mine. I always want to call him nephew, but he's a cousin. And he has learned our language. My great-grandfather, Jose Guzman, was one of the last speakers of the Chochenyo language. J.P. Harrington took crazy notes from him, put him on wax cylinder. His stuff is at the Smithsonian right now. And my daughter, when she was 14 years old, wanted to relearn the language. And so I took her to UC Berkeley, and I had her meet Leanne Hinton, one of the linguists who actually is has started the Breath of Life. Oh, sorry, yeah. Al Frank started that. Leanne Hinton helped her with that. I'm sorry. Let me get the history right, since I'm telling truth. You can tell the rest of that truth afterwards, okay? We went there, and actually, I was really naive. I hadn't known Muwekma at the time very long, and that's the group that is trying to get recognized in our territory. And I took the linguist that Leanne Hinton had given to work with us to the tribe, and the tribe was happy about that, and they were going to relearn the language, but then decided that my children were enrolled in their father's tribe and couldn't learn the language. So we lost out on that. So here comes this young man who picks up the
standing
language.
For the community. We see him with his small hand drum, for black, for brown, for red, for anything. So I would like to say Frankie Rivera. Orale. Frankie stood there with the Kenneth Harding Jr. Foundation. He's done so much. Frankie, I te watcho en el otro lado, carnal. Thank you.
On those shoulders we stand, and those are ancestors that are giving us the strength. And I want to recommit myself here in front of y'all, because that's what we're doing when we come together. We're recommitting ourselves to telling that truth, like Corina said, and to putting first people. We were talking about cuss words a little while ago. I'll give you a very important cuss word that is made sacred in this country. Free market. It's not just a cuss word, it's a lie. There ain't no free market, and it's a bad spell. It's bad memory, bad medicine, and we need to disregard it, throw it in the trash can, into the compost pile. There ain't no free market. It makes objects, it makes commodities out of us, out of our lives. And it says it's okay for this whole group of people to die because they don't buy shit anyway. So I'm making a commitment here. I talked with Corina a while ago. Many of you don't know, but I'm actually a candidate for mayor of San Francisco. And I said to Corina, I said, I want to do this is a healing walk. It's not about winning or losing. It's about a healing walk. And so we want to do a dance at the Civic Center, but I wanted to do it, and then this ceremony came along, because we've been wanting to do ceremonies, and I thought, wow, this is great. This is one of the ceremonies that we have to do for healing. So my commitment is that, to continue to put people first. But more than that, original nation issues have to be priority, because they're based not on that cuss word, free market, which is a lie and bad medicine, based on human values, which is what we're doing here, which is what we do every day. So thank you, Corina. Thank you, Malo Malo, to all of who are here. And let's sing that one word. Caminando means walking. We continue to walk. No change is a fast-paced change. It's always a walking change. Caminando, caminando a la libertad. Vamos caminando hacia la libertad. And may this healing continue. Also, I'm one of the many, many, many Catholics who are against what's going on in Washington, D.C. right now, a completely deplorable ignoring of the truth of what really has happened here, and we will work to revoke that decision. Thank you.
Here. And they didn't know anything about Serra. And so when I told them afterwards, they said, wow, it seems pretty personal to you. And it is. I know people, and I know others do, a couple of women who are 114 years old, and they remember mission times, and they remember the stories of their aunties who were 128 years old. And so it's very fresh. These are not things that we've learned in a book that hurt us. These aren't things we saw on TV that hurt us. These are our families, never changing, always here. These are our families. And why do we need this Catholic Church? They're always trying to feed people. Oh, we'll feed you. Well, who made us hungry? They're always trying to put clothes on us. Well, who called us naked? They're always saying, oh, we helped you with this. Yeah, well, who hurt us to need help in the second place? I'm really happy to see everyone here. And thank you for the fruit. That was lovely. I'm really happy that everybody is here today. I had to steal a car to get here and probably wreck my relationship, but I'm here. I have no idea if there's a way to decanonize somebody. Sounds rather painful, and I don't mind that. But there are things that we can be doing, something similar to what my brother Rico was saying. There are things that we can be doing to strengthen our side, our people. We need to be learning our languages. Take that language away from whoever is keeping it and saying it's theirs, and take it back and make it everyone's. Creator gave language to everyone to make things right in the world. Learn your languages. You say you don't have a language. You say you don't have a tribe. I come from a tribe. Well, how many people heard of the Hollywood Indians? Right. Because she interviewed me. She knows. We were the largest tribe in Southern California, out in the islands, Island of the Blue Dolphins, yeah? Well, we have 800 people left. And we still, even though we have something like 25 words, we are learning those 25 words. And you can learn the words of your neighbors, because back in the day when we married out at least 7 villages. So in those villages, everybody spoke different languages. So it's okay to learn a language that's across the bridge. It's okay. It's historical. Learn your languages. Weave your dang baskets. When you go gather material for baskets, you are poking the eye of this church. When you are learning your language, you are poking the eye of this church. Because we're supposed to not care about any of that anymore. As evident, we care a great deal. This insult of making an agent of the inevitable, a person who thought that the Inquisition was a really great idea and begged the church to please let him come do it over here, we're done with it. The few of us that remain, we are done with it. So we need to get stronger in who we are. We know we've been decimated. Well, let's just get over it. You know, it's time to just stand up. And to not be afraid. And our people used to tell the truth all the time. We knew in community who did what, who helped us and who hurt us. And nowadays we've been trained to, oh, don't say anything. So then somebody moves into an organization, it blows up, and our people can't be helped because nobody said anything. Nobody has to be rude, but we have to be who we are.
and we never lied. Well, when we lied and we got caught, we admitted it, so that's a good thing. You know, we're just human. But thank you all for coming. If I had time, I'd sing a song, but I think I see the hook. No, okay, no hook. It's all right, we're going to sing this. To speak the truth and ask for accountability as to why our ancestors, our people, our relatives, our history, our stories are not being told or regarded with any kind of truth. You know, as an Oglala person, one of the things that really upset me is when we talk about Wounded Knee and what happened and the medals that have not been rescinded and the cavalry that is still considered heroes and war heroes by the U.S. government. When I go back home, they're still considered war heroes. That was one of the reasons why Junipero Serra, really, this issue counted, really spoke to me. Even though I'm not California Native people, this issue touches our people as well, because it's about erasure. It's about someone else wanting to erase our history and keep us oppressed and not allowing us to be able to stand up and make them accountable for what truly happened. You know, and the other thing that I found is that there's a marriage here. There's a marriage between the State of California Tourism Department and the billions of dollars that they make off of the mission system and the tourist attraction, the international tourist appeal that is to come to these missions and make sure they milk you for everything you've got to buy in their gift shops. And the other part of the partnership is the public school system that buys into this with training and socially conditioning all children, but especially our children, to believe in this system that is corrupt, that is full of imperialism, that talks about the free slave labor force and international export and import business that has been involved since the minute that they landed on these lands, and they want to continue to do so. And the third partnership, as we know, is the mission system and the Catholic Church that is kind of orchestrating the whole thing and blessing this bullshit and wanting to keep it as not only a now-present system, but also part of the... They want to make sure it's concrete and cemented into the future system. So what's really going on here is not the canonization of someone who evangelized, you know, California, but it's making sure that our stories are never going to be told. It's making sure that they're never going to be accountable, and it's making sure that what the murder, rape, and torture of our people stays that way, quiet, underground, and cemented, never to be brought up again. So I'm coming here, and I get really angry thinking about it and talking about it, because when we talk about the canonization, we're also talking about how corrupt the state of California is, how corrupt the U.S. government is with being okay with that, how corrupt the public school libraries and all these streets and all these statues that buy into this crap and that want us, again, to believe in this and make sure our children believe in this, too. So they can spend thousands of dollars sending children to the Museum of Tolerance to learn about a Holocaust that took place over there, but they don't want to learn about the Holocaust that took over here and be accountable for that. So, again, I want to thank everybody for allowing us to be here with all of you. It's been a wonderful day to be in prayer, in ceremony, and awesome civil disobedience, because that's our social responsibility as Native people, Indigenous people, is to stand up and speak our mind. And apparently that's supposed to be our constitutional right, but look at all the fucking cops here. Excuse my language. They want to make sure that we're chained and leashed and our civil disobedience is tame and toned down. That says a lot about our First Amendment right, right? Anyways, I want to thank you again for allowing me to speak. I'm humbled. I'm touched. You have amazing leaders here. Karina Gould is awesome, Wounded Knee. I'm looking around here and all my relatives, and I'm awestruck and amazed to be included here. Thank you.
I could tap dance, I guess, while we wait for the next
Avinu Malkeinu, Imenu Malkeinu, Avinu Malkeinu, Onenu Manenu, Kien Banu Mashin, Asei Lanu, Sevasta Vakense, Asei Manu, Sadaka Vahese Veroshenu, Avinu Malkeinu. Avinu Malkeinu, Aninu Manu, Kibanu Manu.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that with us today. Okay, thank you so much. I'm going to ask our friend Grey Wolf to come up and to share some words with us. And then we're going to gather together in a circle, and we're going to close up with the American Indian Movement song. And so if you guys are getting ready, restless or whatever, I know it's a long time, and I'm just really thankful for all of you guys that came out here today in the middle of the week, in the middle of the day, for so many people to have showed their love and to really believe in what this is amazing to me. So thank you again. So here's Grey Wolf.
It took us a while to get here because we were down in Carmel, and I wanted to be here because we've got so many good friends up here in the city of, where am I? I have been in, last week we were in Phoenix, and then we, Carmel today, and now we're here. But one of the things that happened on the way up here, we were starting to get all kinds of text messages from all these people saying that in spite of all our efforts, the Pope made Junipero Serra a saint. And they were all depressed. Oh, my God, we failed. And I said, no, if you thought that we were going to stop this, you were totally in dreamland. That's not going to happen. I knew this was going to take place, but that's not what we were trying to do. When we started this whole thing, we started at Carmel, of all places, because that's where he's buried. And we said, it's not so much about stopping the canonization, it's about educating people on what happened. So anybody who feels that we failed, well, then, you know, fine with that. I didn't fail, and neither did you guys, because we're not done. You know, if you guys think we're done, not going to happen. There's so much more we can do if our point is to educate. Then we have a long way to go, because I'm finding out people have no idea what this is all about. You know, the event we were at last week was the dismantling the doctrine of discovery, which causes so much trouble, so many problems. There's so many issues that we have to address, you know, and this is not a failure. This is not a failure. This is a success. Because what happened when we first decided to do Carmel Mission, nobody cared. All of a sudden, we start seeing people care and starting to educate themselves on what really happened. That's a success, see? So even the Pope starts asking questions. What are the Indians all mad about? You know, I don't see nothing wrong. We made them think. And like I said, we're not done. I mean, it'll probably never be undone. It's not. That's not the point. The point is we will educate people on how indigenous people of California, but it's not just California. See, because my people, we don't come from California. My tribe comes from Tucson, Arizona. What sits across the street from our reservation? San Javier Mission. The same missions that came through California, across Arizona, into New Mexico, and all the way into Texas. All our people were affected by these things. And so that's why, to me, today and all the days that are going to be after this are not failures. And I want everybody to understand that. We didn't fail. We succeeded. Because now they know how we feel. All this time they didn't know how we felt. You know? They thought, oh, we're just going to go along with it. No, not going to happen. We're going to continue to educate. This is just like a start, you know? I'm having too much fun. I don't know where I'm at half the time, but I'm having a lot of fun. So let's have a big cheer for succeeding. Ready?
Yay!
Thank you. Hi,
Lisa.
Hi.
Look at that. And there's Nanette. All my friends are here. I'm not going to talk about that. Oh, Wounded. You know, my good buddy Wounded. Hey, who else is here? Wow, everybody's here. And the reason I'm not taking these off is because my eyes are so bloodshot red from not sleeping that I just decided to keep these on. You know, I don't want to scare nobody. So, again, thank you. We're going to do the AIM song now?
Okay.
Good. Where's our singer? Sure.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. I just wanted to say that in July 23rd, we attended the St. Knot Center forum that was held in Mission San Jose in Fremont, and the curator of this concentration camp, Andy Galvan, suggested that we get in free and that we host ceremonial and cultural events here. And personally, I find his pompous ideas an insult. Why should we be involved in a religious system that denies and blame shifts atrocities? I also wanted to say that I find the Pope's message to be empty and insincere when the colonization of our people continues to the present day, when we're fighting for our own religious freedom, we're fighting to save sacred sites, burial grounds, we're fighting land and water rights, sustainable food rights, and we are also fighting to rid ourselves of mascots. So that's what I wanted to say, that this is just ridiculous, and we need to continue to educate, educate, and educate. Thank you.
The nation that exists, this is a direct effect of what Junipero Serra has brought to our ancestral land. And we have to deal with this emotion today. And that's just on an emotional level. That's not on a physical and a mental level and a spiritual level. That's just my emotion. And it's very difficult with all these energies being thrown. All of these energies being thrown. When I know that my relatives are in D.C., half of them are there to speak to the Pope to tell him no. And the other half are there in support, celebrating the murderer. This is difficult. This is the difficult reality. No, it's not complicated, but it is difficult. The truth is difficult. To be honest is to be difficult. Sheruru, for each and every one of you who came and stood here today for this length of time to be educated, to participate in prayer, to do something. Instead of just throwing your hands up and saying, I can't do nothing, or they're going to canonize them anyway. But being honest is the most difficult thing to do in a world that is based off of lies. So you are all warriors of truth standing here today. And you have a choice once you leave this circle, to go out and live your life in truth, or to live out the continued lie that was built to keep us oppressed as human beings, to keep us against one another. You have a choice. The world has a choice to know the truth or deny it. That's why it's been so difficult for me, because my relatives are Catholic. My relatives are savages. My relatives are everything in between. We didn't choose for this to happen to us. I didn't choose for them to come and rape and murder and steal my ancestral homeland. We didn't choose for that. I didn't choose to be divided amongst my people. I didn't choose that. I didn't choose to learn the English language or the Spanish language. We didn't choose that. We forget. We forget that they came over and forced these things upon our people. And we're still suffering today. And I'm just trying to be an honest man and stand so that my children have truth. So that my children have truth. Because there's no benefit for anybody if it's based off of a lie. There's no benefit. So that's why I get frustrated. That's why I get hurt. That's why the emotions come. Because of the trauma that was inflicted, that's in our DNA. The hurt and the pain and the suffering. But you know what else is in there? The beauty. The beauty. Let's celebrate resistance. Let's celebrate resilience. Let's celebrate those who can still come up here and introduce themselves in their language. I don't care if you speak English. I don't care if you speak Spanish. If you can speak our language, let's celebrate that true indigeneity. Let's celebrate the fact that we still can sing our songs. It's hard to be positive. It's very difficult. The enemy is always out there trying to attack us in that negative.